ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां मालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम् सर्ववेदान्तसिद्धान्तगोचरं तमगोचरं गोविंदं परमानंदं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोस्म्यहम्। सो वी वर सीइंग यस्टरडे अबाउट हाउ अ स्टूडेंट मस्ट अप्रोच द टीचर। वर्स नंबर 32 इज व्हाट वी सॉ, कर्टेसी ऑफ अप्रोच एंड क्वेश्चनिंग। So it was said that Ukta Sadhana Sampanna Tattva Jignyasur Atmanaha. The student who is equipped with these qualifications and who wants to know the Supreme, Tattva Jignyasur, and where is the Supreme, this is one's own self, Atmanaha. Upasidet Gurum Pragnyam. One must go to the teacher. Who is this teacher? Who is awakened? Prajna. And ask, yasmad bandha vimokshanam. Ask how to get free from this bondage. So what is the courtesy of approach? What is that which one should ask the teacher? All those things that we saw yesterday. Now here in the next one, the qualities of such a teacher are mentioned. So qualities of a student, what one must have, that was described earlier, that a person must have those 10 qualifications, 9 plus this one, bhakti, 10 qualifications. And so what are the qualities of a student are mentioned. Now what are the qualities of a teacher, that is mentioned in the 33rd verse. श्रोत्रियो अव्रजिनः अकामहतो यो ब्रह्मवित्तमः ब्रह्मणि उपरतः शान्तः निरिन्धन इवानलः अहेतुक दया सिन्धुः बन्धुरानमतां सताम्। नाउ दिस आर द क्वालिटीज ऑफ अ टीचर बिकॉज दिस इज अ प्रकरण ग्रंथ वी शुड नो all the fundamentals. So what are the qualities of a student by which we cultivate that and we go to the teacher, or in the presence of the teacher we cultivate those qualities, and what are the qualities of a teacher also must be known. Because if I don't know that, then I don't know whether the person is capable of removing my root cause of my sorrow or not. And so the Shastra gives both the qualities of a teacher as well as the qualifications of a student. So what does the scripture say here? What does Vivek Chudamani say? First it says Shrotriyaha. One who is well versed in the scriptural knowledge. So either one must have studied the scripture and be well versed in it in this life, or maybe in some past life one has studied but one knows the essence of the scriptural knowledge and one is able to present it, even sometimes using the similar and the same concepts and examples. Like Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi has not studied formally in this life. In his life as Ramana Maharshi, he has not formally studied the Shastra. But he has also done a lot of tapasya and experienced the absolute truth, and some past life must be he would have studied definitely, So the samskar of spiritual knowledge is there. So when Vedic scholars used to come to him, clarifying, asking some clarifications that, you know, there's some apparent contradictions, we are not able to understand, he would very effortlessly just explain. And sometimes the explanations would be as given in the Shastra. So why is this Shastra, why is the person to have this knowledge? Number one, it is a time-tested knowledge. It is a non-personal knowledge. It is a knowledge which is not written by some few people. Our Shastra is based on the revelations to the minds which have gone beyond the ego. So they are eternal principles, especially Brahma Vidya. Other things may even change by time, but Brahma Vidya remains the same. So it is time tested. It is an apaurusheya. It is a non-human creation, non-personal creation. So individual raga and dvesha or the limitations of human mind don't affect this knowledge. Number three, it is that knowledge which has a maximum logical appeal and also the ability to transcend logic and go beyond the buddhi without appearing illogical, irrational. How to go to the borders of the buddhi, to the, what Gurudev used to say, you know, frontiers. So one goes to the borders, to the frontier, and then one crosses over. So the potential of the buddhi is utilized, the human potential is utilized, one goes up to the maximum and then one crosses over. Where one has made the buddhi, as we saw, you know, sukshma vivek is done, atma anatma vivek is done, and there is a process. So the process is such that when this process is done, people will be able to make the buddhi sharp, subtle, you know, single pointed, and through steady contemplation, understanding, etc., one goes beyond meditation, one goes beyond. So many masters have applied this method and discovered the truth. So it is a time-tested knowledge, very, very logical, non-personal, and using it, it's like a proper roadmap. So when a roadmap is available, why should I, wander around without proper guidance? Time is definitely saved because I don't have to reinvent the wheel. And very important is, if the teacher has the knowledge of the scripture, the teacher can make you also independent. A disciple becomes independent only when the teacher is well versed in the scripture, because the teacher can hand over the scripture and say, this is what is explained to you, this is a guide map, follow this, you reach the path. So the dependency of the student on the teacher is not there. It's a different matter that the student continues to associate with the teacher and take the guidance and evolve. But the dependency factor is not there. That's what Gurudev did to all of us. And he would insist that you sit in the class with a book in the hand. Why did he do that? Because if Shastra is in our hand, we have a map, we can walk the path. So he would always say there is no Chinmaya philosophy. He never created a cult. He brought the scripture to us. This is what the time-tested knowledge is. This is what our tradition is. This is what the Vedic knowledge is. Now you can walk the path. Not knowing our scriptures only, we got exploited. And even today, so many people continue to get exploited because they blindly just trust. And Gurudev would even encourage people to question. The whole scriptures are a result of questions and answers. The dialogue between the student and disciple, student and the teacher. So the knowledge of the scripture also gives all these. One more reason is the scripture gives proper analogies, and there are proper systems, steps. Contrast that with many other teachers who don't ascribe to scriptures, who will not explain anything about the scriptures. One has to constantly depend on what their knowledge is, number one. Number two, each student has a different temperament. How much will the teacher be able to identify each one's temperament and guide? In a scripture, it is like a subjective science. Gurudev would say it's like a proper science, and these masters are subjective rishis. So different temperaments they have already considered. So there are different paths already given in the Shastra. For the intellectual, there is Jnana Marg. For the emotional, there is Bhakti Marg. For the dynamic, there is Karma Marg. Then there is Raja Yoga. And even in those, there are some varieties. Bhakti Marg, you have the Navada Bhakti of Shabari. You have Navada Bhakti of Prahlad. Then you have Narad Bhakti Sutra. Different, systems through which one can reach the Supreme. In Jnana Marg, there is a... Neti-neti, negation, then there is an assertion where we assert what is the truth. Then there is a who am I inquiry. So which method suits which student, the teacher will also know, as well as the student themselves can become independent. And if they want to shift, they will shift based on their understanding. And it's a proper system. Otherwise, spiritual path is a razor's edge. One doesn't know. There is no proper path laid out that way. It's a pathless path. Because our vasanas are different. We don't know what is the next vasana manifesting in the next moment. We may choose a particular path, but something else only manifests. So, a lot of complications are there as far as human evolution is concerned. And it is not about one life that we are talking. It's about many, many lives. So how do we ensure that the person finds a direction, finds a path properly and walks? Scripture gives that proper time-tested knowledge. What are the obstacles? How to overcome them? It's a proper science, documented, very well documented. And the proof of that is all the saints who have followed and realized. So when one follows the scriptural tradition, today there are so many people who are very happy to say, don't refer to scriptures. There's no need to go back to the scriptures. One doesn't understand what is the loss when there is no scriptural backing. It's like telling that, science, we don't want to go back to what the masters or the scientists have discovered. You find out on your own and keep doing. There's a wealth of knowledge. One is just missing out on that whole thing. And also the scripture knowledge is such that it helps the student also in the sense that the student also understands when one comes in that tradition of the Guru Shishya and the Shastra has been passed on, when the disciple also takes up the sadhana of reflection, like what we are doing right now. We are talking on the scripture. So, one is contemplating also on the same system that is there in the Shastra, on the same knowledge that is there in the Shastra. And the person is not, diverting, not getting distracted, not bringing one's own philosophy into place. Because one constantly thinks, is this approved by the scripture? Am I doing enough justice to what the Shastra says? Is my sadhana enough? Today I may not be able to experience what the scripture is saying, but because I have faith in what the Shastra says is true, just because I don't experience it, I will not negate it. There are so many people out there who just say that, you know, what is written here? Why are you bothered? Just focus on what you experience. What we experience is very limited. Our senses themselves cheat us. What we see is not real. Then how can we believe our experience? So experience, if I depend only on my experience to keep moving forward, that is not appropriate enough. Because my experience can be anything. It could be good, it could be ugly, it could be bitter, it could be negative, positive, anything. And after all, it's just an experience. Same situation, maybe after 5 years, I would respond to it very differently. So how much limitation is there of human mind? Shastra is much beyond. That's why faith is required in the scripture. When the definition of faith was given, it was said, Shastrasya Guruvakyasya Satya Buddhyava Dharana. The entire path is given in the Shastra. I may be in step number 3 and I may not realize, I may not know right now what is Samadhi, what is Avikalpa Samadhi, what is Nirvikalpa Samadhi, but at least I know the entire path, I know the milestones, I know the obstacles, I know how to overcome. So Shastra equips us properly. The ego tries to play a lot of discipline, you know, it makes us believe something which is very finite, which is temporary. So it deceives us actually. By rejecting the Shastra, bondage can only keep increasing. Time. It just, I keep postponing the entire realization itself gets postponed in that sense. So Shastra is a very, very important aspect. And a person who is established in scripture is a person whom one goes to. Very meaning of Shastra is Shasanat Trayate Iti Shastram. That which protects us by its instructions. And it protects us from all these. Our own tricks of the mind, protects us from dependency, protects us from experimentation. It is time tested, proper knowledge. And hence it is that every great master you will see has codified this knowledge, has helped to propagate this systematic knowledge. According to their times, they would have created ways and means by which this same knowledge is made more appealing, applicable to the lives of people. So if a Shankaracharya composes Bhajagovindam, that Bhajagovindam is based on the Shastra only. All the principles of the scripture is what he is composing it on. If Puja Gurudev writes Kindle Life, Self-Unfoldment, the base is the Shastra. If the base is only my experience, it is very limited. And the methods which the Shastra applies also are so beautiful. The examples, the analogies, the logic is a proper systematic body of knowledge. So if one example, so if one logic doesn't appeal to me, there are other types of logic also which the Shastra gives. There are experiential proofs it will give. Analogies, you know. So a person who has rooted himself or herself in the Shastra, one must go to that kind of a teacher. Shrotriya, well versed in the scriptures. You know, people like Tapon Maharaj, Gurudev, even Vivekananji, all of them properly rooted in the scriptural knowledge. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa went to such teachers, learned from them, tried out different paths, got established in the truth. But he never told Ramakrishna Vivekananda his own philosophy. He spoke to Vivekananda about the Shastra. So Vivekananda ji quotes the Upanishads, the famous speech of World Parliament of Religions. The example that he used there, that all the rivers ultimately go into the ocean and they merge. That is the example in the Upanishads. And he quotes also many places. This is the Upanishad, what our culture says, what our scripture says. So go to a teacher. First qualification is the teacher must be well versed with the scriptural knowledge and must be established in that knowledge. Shrotriya. And because this knowledge is passed on through the oral tradition, that's why Shrotra. Shrotra means ears. Shrotriya means one who has heard very well through the tradition. So Shrotriya indicates one who has gained scriptural knowledge through the tradition of the Guru and Shishya by listening to the teacher, sitting at the feet of the teacher and listening. Then that person is well versed. Because one has gained the traditional knowledge in the way in which it is supposed to be gained, learning it from a teacher, because there are lots of subtleties. It is not easy to understand. And not only that, one may misunderstand. Like a simple meaning, the word Atma, in some places it means mind, in some places it means Jivatma, in some places it means the absolute self, in some places it even means body. It means Buddhi. Taittiriya Upanishad, the word Atma is used for all the five koshas also, as well as for the Supreme Truth also. Now, if I am not well versed, I just take a book and open it and just start reading, I may not understand. So, Shrotriya means a teacher who has understood the scripture in the tradition where one has had a teacher, one from a teacher one has learnt, has understood properly. So, such a person, Shrotriya. Then, Avrajina. Avrajina means sinless. Now, sinless means does not mean that has never committed any sin from the birth. No, not like that. So, agitations of the mind, negative tendencies of the mind, which make us compromise, those are called as the sin. Which make us not live up to the human potential, which will harm me and harm others, or that is called as sin. So avrajina means when one has come to this path, one has, you know, developed those qualities, one has a resolve that I want to know the truth, one has dropped all the tendencies which make a person sin. One has gone beyond the negatives. So every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. We must have heard that saying. So it is not that the saint has not done anything wrong at all. Everybody makes mistakes, everybody goes through this process. But here is a person who has gone beyond that, has dropped all that, and somebody who has the root cause of sin is. In the Gita, when Bhagavan was asked that, what is that which pushes a person to commit sin? Though unwilling, why is that person doing the wrong things? What is that factor in the person which is pushing that person to compromise and do the wrong things? Even though one knows it is wrong, and many times one is not willing to do it, still there is some force which pushes the person. So there Bhagavan says, Kama esha krodha esha rajoguna samudbhavaha. The desire and anger born out of rajoguna. So when there is attachment, the desire and anger born out of that attachment is what makes us sin and compromise. That is one aspect. Why the desire there? That is because I don't know who am I. I think myself as jiva, limited entity. So the person who has gone beyond these two, who has overcome rajas, overcome attachment, gone to the level of sattva guna, is struggling and striving to live in sattvic tendencies, and ultimately has crossed over into that realm where it is beyond merit and demerit, beyond sin and, you know, the good actions. Like in Bhaja Govindam, it is said, Punya Punya Vivarjita Pantha. One is gone beyond Kartritva, doership. So one has gone beyond sin and merit. Such a person now will not commit any sin, because sin is committed as long as there is something I hold on to, which I want to protect, which makes me compromise. So avrajina literally means that one doesn't get carried away by this rajoguna, by one's own attachments. One doesn't compromise. That kind of an uncompromising attitude, that is this avrajina. Somebody who has given up, like a Ratnakar transforms into a Valmiki. So the negative tendencies of the past, the tendency to hurt somebody, harm somebody, loot somebody, plunder their wealth, all those tendencies are gone. It's a different matter that maybe if the result has to be faced in a particular way, it will come back to that person. The result will come back, but then the person just faces that karma phala with dignity. It doesn't make that person again compromise. So avrajina means that. When a person has dropped the cause for sin, avrajina. And no more that person will sin. That is another important aspect. So one has done the prayaschitta, or one has gone beyond the very cause of sin, the attachments and the ego. And hence there is no possibility of further compromising and further committing sin, where one disturbs oneself, one disturbs others. So shrotriyaha, avrajinaha. You see, these qualities, if we remember, if we understand, when we go to seek a teacher, we will remember these qualities. And if these qualities are what one is looking for in the teacher, one will not get exploited. Nowhere here it will be said that, you know, a person who can walk on water, who can create miracles, who can manifest some ash, who can do this, do that miracle. None of those qualifications are given here. Unfortunately, we think that a person who can do some miracle has some great power, so then one goes to that person. One person like that, he went, advanced spiritual seeker, one can call. He went to meet Kanchi Periyavar. So the pontiff before Jayendra Saraswati ji, he is called Kanchi Periyavar, the great master established in the truth. So this person went to meet the master and manifested, you know, one plate of fruits and offered it to the master. So when he did this miracle of manifesting the plate of fruits, the master did this and the plate of fruit disappeared. Second time he did that, manifested the plate of fruit, and the master again did that, plate of fruit went. And he said, don't use these powers for all these things. These are siddhis, these are obstacles on the way, and these are not to be used for all these. So a person must be very clear that what are these qualifications of a teacher. Kanchi Periyavar looks very simple and humble, a very ordinary person. If you look at him, his appearance will be like a tapasvi. There is no pomp and glory and show or nothing. If the person is not heading that position as a head of the Kanchi Mat, one may not even know that this person is realized. But all the qualities mentioned here will be there in him. Shrotriya, Avrajina, Akamahata, all those. Those are the real qualities. And these are qualities which one has to look for. Now look for meaning, not that, you know, as Guruji, as Gurudev would say, that go for guru hunting or guru shopping. When I come across a spiritual teacher, I should look for these qualities. That will help me to identify the right teacher and also protect me from getting carried away. So Shrotriya Avrajinaha. Akamahataha. The person is not affected by kama. Kama means two things, passion and selfishness, both. Again, this is one of the very important qualities, because kama is the source of the other six, other five impurities. Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya. They all come because of kama. Akamahataha means one who has no selfish interest and who has risen above lust and passion. Again, an important qualification, because many times one justifies any indulgence and in the name of freedom one says, what rules, no rules, live a free life, you know, break all boundaries, don't be limited by these are shackles upon you. Because mind can play a lot of tricks, and indulge in the name of, you know, free life. That is not spiritual life. Tapasya, withdrawal, single-pointedness, selflessness, all that is spiritual life. Indulgence cannot be ever spiritual life. Where he says here, that's why he says akamahataha. Hata means destroyed. Akamahataha means he is not destroyed by kama. The mind is not engaged in kama at all. Neither in selfishness, meaning one's own projection, one's own, you know, popularity, power, position. Not interested in that. Has a higher purpose, a higher vision. Does not put oneself above Shastra, God, country, culture, all that. So not carried away by selfishness, not affected by passion. The mind is beyond passion. The mind has, you know, in fact, this word akamahata has the solution to get out of kama. The kama is a lot of energy. It's tremendous amount of energy at the body and the mind and the pranic level. If that energy is not utilized properly, it will destroy us. It will make us more indulgent, or it will create suppression and suffocation. Both are extremes and both will destroy. So to channelize that energy properly to a higher purpose, that is the solution. Selflessness is a solution for passion. That entire energy, if I love a cause which is greater than me, which is a higher purpose, and I am very, very deeply associated and identified with that cause, entire dynamism of the body, prana and the mind can be directed towards that. And that's how one overcomes that passion. Of course, there are other methods, other things one has to do. Live in self-control, control the ears, control the eyes. No, those aspects are there. But the key factor is turn the attention of the mind towards something which is noble, which is higher, which will demand my energies fully. When one exhausts oneself in doing selfless work, kama has no place in one's life after that. So, akamahataha. Otherwise, kama will destroy us. This expression is very powerful. Kamahata and akamahata. Generally, we are destroyed by kama. Here is a person who has risen above kama. The most difficult aspect of spiritual life is this. But the solution also is there in this. The very first step of spiritual life, nishkama karma, is the method for kamahata. Yesterday we saw those steps. In that, nishkama karma is the first step. So when a person is utilizing the energies to serve the higher, the mind is not engaged in thinking about the body and the pleasures and the lower things, that person will overcome. So the energy is not suffocated in suppression, the energy is not wasted in indulgence. One uses it for uplifting oneself and for serving the society. Akamahata. So the teacher, and the teacher who has gone beyond karma, you will see the look of the teacher is free from lust. The touch of the teacher is free from lust. The speech of the teacher is free from lust. The mind doesn't indulge in any of that. When we are immature, when we are still children in spiritual life, then all those things will happen. Comments will come, actions will happen, eyes will wander, many things happen. So by understanding this, that the teacher is somebody who is beyond karma, has gone beyond karma by great effort, it's not easy. So many things happen, exploitation happens, and the faith of people in spiritual life is destroyed, is shattered because of this thing, that one is not akamahata. Till the last minute, one has to live in that kind of abstinence and self-control, because any time the mind can turn. Till one has not realized the absolute truth, one has to be so alert and careful. A teacher was asked by the student, because the teacher was talking about desire and the limitation of desire and how to overcome desire and all that. So the student asked the teacher have you conquered desire? So the teacher didn't reply. So the student asked once again. Teacher didn't reply at all. Years passed. Now the teacher has become old. And now he has fallen sick and is going to drop the body. Just before he is dropping the body, just few moments before that, he looks at the disciple and he says, now I have conquered desire, I can say that. And in the next few moments, he drops the body. What was the lesson there? That one has to be so alert. Because if one says, yes, I have conquered desire, there are chances that the mind can become again inalert and again the desire will bounce back. So one has to ensure that this alertness remains, self-control remains. You see, any great master who has realized the truth, are they not living in tapasya? Are they not living in self-control? Are they indulging in the name of? They have gone beyond punya and papa. Nothing will touch them. Nothing will affect them. But they will still live in self-control. It has become their way of life because they don't want to indulge in the tiny, toys of life. Even a student who is walking the path, forget the teacher who is established. Even the student who is walking the path, it is said, Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka, Sampatti, Mumukshutvam. One has to withdraw. So these three qualities, Shrotriyaha, well-versed in the scripture, then Avrajinaha, sinless, Akamahataha, not destroyed by karma, but in fact very, very selfless, Akamahataha. Fourth is Brahmavittamaha. So Brahmavittama means the best amongst the knower of Brahman. It is a superlative degree. Brahmavit, Brahmavittaraha, Brahmavittamaha. Now the best amongst the knower of Brahman means what? Doesn't mean that in realized master there is A grade, B grade, C grade. Not like that. Brahmavittamaha means person who is very well established in an absolute truth at the highest level, where one has experienced that there is only one Brahman. There is nothing else. Where the going coming has stopped, person is not getting into samadhi, coming back, getting into samadhi, coming back. There the glimpses are happening of Brahman. So Brahmavit, Brahmavittara, Brahmavittama. In this Yoga Vashishta, there are these seven Saptajnana Bhumika. In that, the last one is this. So Brahmavittama, the best amongst the knower of Brahman. Meaning very well established in Brahman. No coming, going, coming, going. Properly established. Yad gatva na nivartante taddhama paramam mama. Bhagavan says in the 15th chapter of the Gita. Having established there, one doesn't fall back into ignorance to think that the world is real. So, generally speaking, two qualities are always told. Even in the Upanishads, it is said, in the Mundaka Upanishad, they said, Tad vijnanartham sagurum eva abhigachet shrotriyam brahmanishtham. Two qualities are always mentioned. To know the truth, one should go to the teacher. And who is the teacher? Shrotriya and Brahmanishta. If these two are there, the other qualities are covered in that. Because without being Akamahata, one cannot be knower of Brahman. Without being sinless, one cannot be knower of Brahman. So generally, these two qualities will include all the others. So that's what he's saying here. Brahmavittama and Shrotriya. Then he says, Brahmani Uparataha Shantaha. Brahmani Uparata means one who has withdrawn from the world and abides only in Brahman. The mind no more runs behind worldly things. Uparati we saw. Uparati means to withdraw. So Brahmani Uparata means one who has withdrawn the mind established in Brahman. The craving, the extrovertedness to go out is not there. By prarabdha, if that body has to serve the people, the master will serve. But there is no craving to run out. In fact, the person can withdraw and stay. Like Tapon Maharaj could be absorbed in the truth for such a long time. It just being samadhi itself for such a long time. Brahmani Uparata. And even when they engage in the world with the people, their thinking or their mind is always in the clear knowledge that there is only Brahman, nothing else is happening. So they operate at both these levels. One aspect is Brahman alone exists, nothing is happening. That is the mind absorbed in that. And at the external level also, as they are serving, it is the prarabdha of the body, it is going on. They still see all this as Brahman. So, Brahmani Uparataha Shantaha. Extremely peaceful, serene, calm. Shanta here means the absence of the other five negativities also. Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Madha, Matsarya. They are also not there. Very gentle, very peaceful. In fact, the next verse or so it will come. They are like the spring season. Such a beautiful analogy that is. So Shanta, in the presence of that person, even our mind becomes peaceful. So one of the definitions of santa is this. Jiske santap ka ant ho gaya, wo hai sant. Whose agitations have stopped completely. Whose mind is peaceful. Whose mind is serene. Whose mind is very calm. Doesn't get agitated, disturbed, ruffled. Even if anger has to be used as a tool, one will use it as a tool and drop it. Not affected or overwhelmed by anger. So, Shanta. Brahmani Uparata Shanta. Nirindhana Ivanalaha. Nirindhana Ivanala means is a fire without fuel. Indhana means that. So, one has to take that together. Shanta and Nirindhana Ivanala. Like a steady, like a fire which has consumed all the fuel. Meaning what? in the fire of knowledge, all our vasanas, everything is gone burnt. That person whose vasanas, the fuel of samsara is our vasanas. And our ego strengthens these vasanas. Nirindhana Ivanala means the steady flame of knowledge. It is apparently a contradiction to say that a fire which has consumed all the fuel and has, meaning it has burnt all the fuel and got exhausted. In the world, you will not see a fire without a fuel. It will get exhausted. It will get burnt up. So everything is, you know, the fire disappears. But here it is Shanta and Nirindhana Ivanalaha. The mind is quiet because it has consumed all the vasanas. Ego is destroyed, but the flame of knowledge is on. That's the uniqueness here. The flame of clarity, the knowledge is I am Brahman, I am not the Jiva. So one has gone beyond Jiva, gone beyond vasanas, which is generally the fuel. So Nirindhana Ivanalaha. Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. Beautiful expression this is. Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. Ocean of compassion. Daya Sindhu. Ahetuka Daya Sindhu means causeless compassion. They have nothing to gain from us. They don't want anything. And yet very, very compassionate towards the suffering. They will drop their own absorption in samadhi, quietude, etc. Come down to help the people. Because they have felt inspired, they have felt transformed by this powerful knowledge. It doesn't make a finite into a better finite. This knowledge is that which makes me discover the infinite in me. So one who has understood that, this is the knowledge, is very, very compassionate. So knowledge must bring these two aspects. Vidya dadati vinayam. One is humility it brings. When I am a student and I want to gain the supreme truth, discover the supreme truth, the more I know, the more I understand that I don't know, and the more humble I become. So as a student, vidya dadati vinayam. And as a master, knowledge will invoke compassion. Then that is true knowledge. A master is very deeply compassionate. In fact, Shankaracharya ji says that what is the love of a parent? Highest example of love is the love of a parent. Selfless love, especially the mother. When the mother doesn't have expectation, that is a selfless love. So Shankaracharya ji says, what is the love of a mother is so pure and so unconditional. The love of a teacher or the compassion in the heart of a teacher is like the love of the parents of hundreds of births put together. Still, it will not be adequate to describe that. And because they have nothing to gain from us, they are purely here to uplift us. That's all. Nothing else. They want nothing. So, Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. Very compassionate. Compassionate in general to come down or to share the knowledge with the masses. And compassionate specifically also to guide the student, to help the student to overcome the obstacles. To intensify the sadhana of the student. Yes, the means that the teacher may adopt are different. Sometimes teaching formally through lectures, sometimes through anecdotes in one's own life. Sometimes it can be by more harder methods also. Anything. The teacher may use methods, but the underlying basis is only compassion. So Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. Sometimes the master may test also. Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. We have to understand one aspect here is that the compassion of the teacher, if I understand well, my heart will be filled with gratitude. And I will not compromise in my sadhana. because I understand that the teacher has done so much of sacrifice, that if I compromise, I am not only postponing my liberation, I am also not valuing the sacrifice of the teacher. And the teacher has to put that much more effort to push me to realize the truth. So if I understand that the teacher is here purely because of me, a student must always have the bhav that the teacher-student relationship is from the student standpoint. Why? Because from the teacher standpoint, na bandhur na mitram gurur naiva shishya chidananda rupa shivoham shivoham. From the teacher standpoint, the student also is Brahman only. There is no difference. That's what we said earlier. Brahmani uparata shanta. It was said. The disciple maintains that relationship of a teacher a student. So the kritagnyata must be there. If the master is ahetuka daya sindhu, the student must be kritagnya, full of gratitude, so that a person is able to do the sadhana sincerely and ask the question that if I do this, 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 will I be able to look into the eyes of my teacher without guilt? If I am able to do that, then that action is right. If I cannot do that, and I will feel sad or guilty, then that action should not be done. And the motive force for the mind to control anything wrong which I am doing, the motive force is this gratitude. That if the teacher has given up so much for me, where he has come down to my level to teach, sheerly out of compassion, nothing the teacher wants from me, how can I compromise? So the quality of a teacher is ahetuka daya sindhu. 100 times a student makes the mistake, still the teacher will with love and compassion try to lift the student up. That's the quality of the teacher. But that should not make me take the teacher for granted, because then I have lost out. Every moment in the presence of a master is precious. So as you saw in the beginning, it was said three factors which are factors of grace: manushyatvam, mumukshutvam, and mahapurusha samshraya. This mahapurusha samshraya doesn't come easily. So if I have the company of such a master who is ahetuka daya sindhu, I must make the best every moment, because how long will I be in presence of that master, we don't know. How long the master will be in the body, that also we don't know. So, ahetuka daya sindhu. Dispassion leads to knowledge, knowledge leads to compassion. So the teacher's quality is compassion. Ahetuka daya sindhu. And bandhuranamatam satam. So bandhu means one who is a friend, one who is a, literally it can also mean a relative, but here bandhu is like a friend or like a intimate friend with whom you share everything. Meaning here is a teacher who is not some authoritative figure who is just out there to dominate or dictate or be very harsh or rude. There is a bhav of, as we said earlier, the teacher though thinks that the student is Brahman only. But at a relative level, the role is being played of a teacher and a student. In that role of a teacher and student also, there is an intimacy whereby the bond between the teacher and student is such that they share. The student also has surrendered, teacher also gives himself or herself completely. So there is no hiding. That's what is meant by intimate friend. So there is no hiding, there is no manipulating, there is no, you know, withholding. The teacher also guides the student wholeheartedly. The student also has approached and, you know, there is no false mask basically. The teacher, the student goes to the teacher as one is. Bandhu and Anamatam Satam. Person who is a friend to those who surrender to him. Bandhu Anamatam Satam. So when the student has surrendered, the teacher takes him, accepts, and to find such a teacher and to be accepted by the teacher and to come under the umbrella or the wings of such a teacher is a great, great, great fortune. Now, if you say, how will I find such a teacher? What we spoke earlier, cultivate the qualifications of a student and the right teacher will come into our lives. So that's where we stop for now. Any questions, you are welcome to ask.
Hari Om Swamiji, most of the doubts were clear. Thank you so much.
Right.
Did you have a question?
Huh.
In first, the Avrajaniya, does it, in a way, does it, when he says sins in a way and sinless, does it not in a way, I mean, gone beyond vasanas, or is it, are we talking about somebody, I mean, this is like before we got into the Brahma Nishtha part, would it mean somebody in Shuddha Sattva, or has to, some, the person has to have transcended vasanas?
So here are all the qualities from absolute standpoint also. This is not the description of a student evolving.
Right.
So the person, when we say Avrajina, is not a person who is in the Shuddha Sattva state, where gone beyond Rajas and Tamas and waiting to transcend Sattva.
Right.
That is already done.
Hmm.
So the sinlessness here is an expression of the person's abidance in the truth only. Truth,
okay.
Really speaking, is sinless. Ego will make us sin.
Right. And Swamiji, I'm still a little stuck in the explanation of the, in the understanding rather, of the bhakti as the meaning. I mean, I'm not being able to see the difference between that and basically a combination of mumukshutvam plus uparati plus samadhan, all of that. Somehow it's seeming like a combination of that.
Hmm.
It could not, even if we did not take bhakti as a separate, you know, value, would it not, Tivra Mumukshu, having done all of that, anyway have this bhav?
So, bhakti has not, so in those fourfold qualifications, most of them, if you see, they will be related. So, Vivek is related to buddhi, Vairagya is related to the absence of craving in the mind.
Dhamma,
again, absence of reactions at the mind level. Dhamma, sense level. Uparati, withdrawal of the mind. Titiksha is tolerance at both mind and body level, means BMI level. Shraddha is again a quality of the buddhi, where one is having faith in the scripture and the teacher. Then Samadhan is again absorption of the mind in the goal. Then comes Mumukshutvam, is an intense desire to know the truth. Maybe feeling at the mind level and desire to know the truth, feeling in mind. In all these, the intensity with which I seek, the emotional intensity is what is being indicated by bhakti. When we say Mumukshutvam, that Mumukshutvam is an intense desire to become free. But the love aspect of it has not come. The description of love is identification with the beloved. So the surrender aspect of it has not come. Even when it was said about Shraddha, it was said, Shastrasya Guru Vakyasya Satya Buddhyavadharana. That what the Shastra is saying and what the Guru is saying and how the Guru is living, that is true. The faith is that, described as that. Bhakti towards the Sadguru or Bhakti towards Ishvara or Bhakti towards the Self is not come under any of these. So, here in Vivek Chudamani, that is added separately, saying that the intensity with which I seek the Self-knowledge, the Self-enquiry, because we are in the path of Jnana, we are talking in that sense. If it is Bhakti Marg, we will say, okay, a person is there and then you surrender to that, you know, sorry, a form is there and you surrender to that form, etc. To give us that parallel, that in Bhakti, with what intensity you seek the Lord, with that intensity here, you seek the self. Swaswarupa Anusandhanam. Where I am constantly doing Nididhyasana. The Nididhyasana when I am doing, what is the bhav with which I do Nididhyasana? That intensity of the bhav is what is called as bhakti here. At that time, it is not that I want to become free, I want to become free, I want to become free. Mumukshutvam is not at play at that time. Mumukshutvam is at play before. Vivek, Vairagya, all that has helped me to withdraw the mind to contemplate constantly. So, Shamadhi, Shakka, Sampatti, Mumukshutvam, all those are coming to play. But when I am steadily contemplating on Brahman, Nididhyasana, what is that which engages me in that Nididhyasana, which doesn't allow the mind to wander? Because it's not
the love for the self.
Exactly. So it's not just an intellectual thinking. As Gurudev says, intellect and mind both come together to form the heart. And in the heart, one realizes the Supreme. So the intellect part is the Nididhyasana part. The bhavana part is the heart. That bhavana comes, that is called as bhakti here. That's why both these are very important. Otherwise, our mind will again wander. The shama, dama, uparama, titiksha, shraddha, samadhan will get intensified only with bhakti. So if you apply in devotion language, then it will become very easy to understand. What I really love, my mind is absorbed in thinking about that, the mind will not wander. So if a thing is such a thing, suppose I love cake or I love cricket, now when I am engaged in that, the mind is fully absorbed in that. The feeling is also absorbed in that. So the mind will not wander. But when we are talking of the self, it is nameless, formless, attributeless. How will the mind engage there? Mumukshutvam can lead to bhakti. That's why the 10th one is bhakti. That intense desire to be free will lead me to intensely absorb myself in that contemplation because I don't want anything else. So that bhav is, that's why it is called as bhakti. That bhakti is very crucial.
Okay, because I was thinking like, how can samadhan or mumukshutvam happen, intense mumukshutvam without bhakti?
It can happen, but it will not be sustained. That's the difficulty. Samadhan can easily happen. Absorption of the mind for some time to anyway happens. To sustain that for a long time, that is where the intensity of this bhakti is required. And that's why he says, moksha karana samagriyam bhakti reva gariyasi. So he has given 10 qualifications, 9 qualifications. In those 9, he said mumukshutvam and vairagya are most important. And then he says, even amongst these, bhakti is the supreme. Why? Because till that bhav is not there, and how many people cultivate that bhav of surrender? In devotion language, it is surrender. In this knowledge language, it is complete identification with the self. Just think about it. What is it that makes me love the self? I don't know the self. It is my own nature, but I still don't know. Because I have mumukshutvam, because I have done vivek, I know that self exists. Then I really want to know. That intensity with which I want to know, that is the bhakti here. So a simpler example to understand that is, when I have lost something that I really love, with what intensity will I seek that? Suppose somebody has given me something very precious, maybe some watch or something, very precious to me. Now I lost it. So what intensity with which I will seek? In that intensity when I am seeking the self, because it's my own nature, I have just forgotten it. The intensity comes, that is the bhakti part. The positive aspect, I would say, of mumukshutvam is the bhakti part.
Because Swamiji, it was not like really an objection to bhakti, because one understands the need for bhakti, because we've always heard you say that one of the reasons is if one is sitting for jap and not being able to, if the mind is wandering too much, you've always said that either there is not enough abhyas or there isn't enough love for the goal. So there in itself is the factor of bhakti, where if I don't love what I'm sitting down, if I don't love the Lord or my goal, my mind is going to wander.
Yes.
So the confusion was, I mean, how is it different? Because I thought that the underlying factor for mumukshutvam and samadhan would be bhakti, the emotional investment. Yes. If the emotional investment is not there, then the last two, like you said, will not sustain. They will always, they'll just come and go. So I'll never become a tibra mumukshu. I will always be, won't I always remain among the mumukshu only?
Yeah. It is the underlying factor only.
Okay, got it, Swamiji.
Okay, so we stop here today and...
One small question, if I may.
Yes.
Swamiji, titiksha, which is forbearance, does it sometimes lead to complacency with respect to mumukshatva? And is there some way that one can... cross that and then still maintain mumukshatva? Because if is there a tendency for someone to get used to, you know, becoming complacent when he becomes okay with the problems of the world? Is there
so that possibility is there when I don't understand mumukshutvam properly? When I don't understand titiksha properly, am I audible to you?
Yes,
Swami. So, there are chances that yes, titiksha may lead to complacency if I don't understand titiksha properly. What is titiksha? What is coming to me, I have to accept that before I respond. That is called titiksha. Number one. Apratikara purvakam, it was said. Chinta vilaparahitam. And apratikara purvakam, that was what was said. Without resisting it, without worrying about it, without reacting, I accept this is the situation. But that does not mean I don't do anything about it. Because if I have to respond, that is my today's purusharth that I have to do. Complaining, cribbing, resisting, not accepting, those are to be avoided. So titiksha helps me to bear it, because if there is something that I can do about it and I need to do about it, I must do, because that's a part of my today's purusharth and my duty today. But if there is something that I cannot do anything about, then I will have to accept it and just endure it. So it is not to become complacent, it is to preserve the energies of the mind from unnecessary reactions, which will make only our time get wasted. When I cannot do anything about something, like the weather I cannot control, I'll have to accept, but doesn't mean that I don't do anything about it, where I can move myself to some other place, or come to a cooler place, or if it is raining, come to a shade. But I will have to accept that it is like this now. There is heat, there is rain, there is cold, whatever it is. And then I have to deal with it at the body level. Suppose I am not able to move anywhere. Just be there. And let that situation pass, because it will not be for long. So if I understand titiksha very well, it is not to make me complacent. But if there is a confusion in titiksha understanding, then there is a complacency possibility. Same like ambition and contentment. Contentment can become complacency. But complacency is tamoguna, contentment is sattvaguna. Same way titiksha is sattvaguna. Is to just bear. Somebody told me something and the mind is wanting to react, and I just say, bear it, let it pass. I don't react on it. I just let it go. Now I've intelligently chosen not to react. I accepted, this person told this, fine. Is it valid? Then I take the feedback properly. If it is not valid, let it be. So purushartha, I must continue to do. Then complacency will not happen.
understood. Thank you, Swamiji. Hari Om.
Okay, so for now we will stop here, and our dates of June I will put up on the Telegram group. Most probably it will be 18th to 22nd June. But I will anyway confirm it on the Telegram group. Today is the last day. One gentle reminder that please go on online and make the contribution. Thank you. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.